morning, church, with a risen Savior. Good to see you this morning. Welcome to Open Door Bible Church. We'll get started with just a few announcements. There'll be a raised right order being placed next Sunday, so if you'd like to participate in that, that will be happening next Sunday. VBS is happening this week. If you'd still like to register your children, I believe there are still registration cards in the back, or you could talk to Christine Storms. Children's Church, not this month, but in July, it looks like we'll probably be headed back to having Children's Church. And then the last couple of announcements here. Independence Day celebration, Saturday, July 1st, 4 p.m. Bring your favorite dish to share. If desired, bring fireworks to be set off after dark. And if you'd like to talk to someone about that, you can call Becky Morrison. The address and phone number are listed in the bulletin. Men's Saturday Bible Study, Saturdays, 8:30 a.m. If you'd like more information, talk to Tim Scharf. And the Book Club for Ladies will be meeting again in July, July 20th on Thursday evening. This is Communion Sunday. Everyone who knows and loves the Lord is welcome to celebrate that with us. If you'd like to get a cup from the back table, you can do that as well. Let's move into preparation for worship. Thank you. ponder anew what the Almighty can do. I think that's what Habakkuk was doing. We're going to read for the call to worship, Habakkuk chapter 3, the last three verses. Though the fig tree should not blossom and there be no fruit on the vines, though the yield of the olive should fail and the fields produce no food, though the flock should be cut off from the fold and there be no cattle in the stalls, yet I will exult in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and he has made my feet like hinds' feet and makes me walk on high places. Let's pray. Father, it is good to come together and acknowledge you are our God and you are sovereign, and we look to you in each moment. God, help us as we ponder who you are and what you're up to today. And Lord, would you draw out worship from our hearts, from our spirits, not just from our lips. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you're able this morning, would you stand together and let's lift up the name of Jesus together this morning.
You're worthy of worship, you're worthy of praise, you're worthy of honor, you're worthy of thanks, you're worthy of worship, you're worthy of praise, you're worthy of honor. Is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. Son of man, great I am, healing power is in your hands. Risen one, it is done, sin and death are overcome. Every knee will bow, every tongue will shout, the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. Every eye will see the coming of the King. Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. You're worthy of worship, you're worthy of praise, you're worthy of honor, you're worthy of thanks, you're worthy of worship, you're worthy of praise, you're worthy of honor, you're worthy of thanks. And every knee will bow, every tongue will shout, Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. Every eye will see the coming of the King, Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. Of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
One verse.
With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. Day by day I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
When the race?
When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Let's continue to worship in humility this morning.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, You rescue the souls of men. Always hunger for, oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Lost away. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger.
Let's sing that chorus again. Let's look forward to rejoicing in Christ's finished work on the cross together at the end of the service this morning.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He's my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my death. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ. No power of hell, no power of
my mic, is that on yet? There we go. Thank you. I forgot to check ahead of time. Anyway, just a couple of things before we go through some of the other missions. Yeah, just a couple of things I wanted to mention. One is that Christ for Me is going through some hard times right now, not financial or anything. They've had just some difficulties that they've had to work through, and they're working through those things. And Frida is, having to be part of all of that. So please pray for Frida especially, and for that ministry. It's a wonderful ministry. We want to see keep going. Corey and Leslie are also done in Georgia and on their way back this direction. I'm not sure if they'll actually be here in town, but the next place they need to be is Wyoming. So that's a lot of miles that they're going to be covering. And pray for them as they do that traveling together. And If you're on Facebook, you had a chance to see the stuff that they posted about the rodeo. It was just really fun to watch some of the things that they were involved in. One of the things Corey does is that he's part of the medical team, so that if someone is injured, for instance, bull riding, or a lot of other ways, but the medical team goes out and he's there to help the family and to encourage and be with the family as they're waiting for that whole process to be worked out. So just thought I'd mention those things just as we're going through. But so pray for those things if you would. Now we'll go ahead to the next slide. And we're doing something special this week. Christine Storms and Reagan Campbell have gotten hundreds of people involved. Anyway, everybody that's involved in some way, would you lift your hand at VBS if you're involved in some way? Look around, see who all is helping. And now we're going to take a minute to just pray. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. Let's just pray for this upcoming outreach and that all the hard work would be paid. We would see that there would be a real excitement in our own church family, but also that there would be some from the area that would come and want to be involved and would hear the gospel. And so let's just pray about that real quick. Thank you, Lord God, for the fact that we have the opportunity and the privilege this next week of going and having this VBS here in our church home. And so we just ask, Lord, that many people would come. We ask that the word would go out clearly, that friends and neighbors would come, and we ask that your gospel would be presented clearly and that would be people who would respond. We thank you for all of the folks that have been involved already and for those that will be helping in this next week. We just ask your strength and encouragement for each one. We ask this in your name. Amen. Next missionary I want to just deal with is Frank and Kathy King. We got a letter from them this last week, and the church, there's a lot of stuff a while back that they went through, and they were, Frank was again put in as elder, but the people who were pursuing the health and wealth gospel have taken a large number with them as they left. Okay, so that's always hard to watch people leave, especially for false teaching of that sort. That being said, they're also seeing numerous people come to Christ, which is really exciting. They've had a number of funerals, and funerals, if they're evangelical in that country, are great opportunities to share the true gospel and the joy and the wonder of being a believer and going to be with the Lord. And so they've had two or three of those with numerous people there, and there have been some people saved as a result of a loved one passing into the Lord's presence. So keep praying for Frank and Kathy King. They really want to praise the Lord for the fact that a bunch of their young people are involved in camps, and that's always a really cool thing when your young people are going and being staff or serving. And then they ask for prayers about a number of things. I'm not going to give you all of them, but for the spiritual impact of the kids going to camp, if there are those that are unsaved, that they would be saved, and that the others would be challenged and that they would grow. For the leaders in the Italian church, even though it's a hard time right now and they've lost many people, for them to be able to say, okay, God knows what he's doing and we trust him and we're going to keep moving forward pursuing him. And then just for open doors, for them to be able to share the gospel with people there where they are in Italy. Let's go ahead and go to some church family things. Bob and Cammie are both here today, and Cammie's feeling well, and she's excited. Her daughter gets married next week, and her son comes home from Japan. So how cool is that? And so we're praying with the family. Next week will be Meredith's wedding, and a great family time for them. So just pray for all that and pray for Cammie with her health and through that, all of that. Continue to pray for Bill Butler. He's gone through some really hard times this last week. Still that don't know what they're going to do. The radiation treatments are ongoing, but he has several other options that he can pursue. So please pray about that. I did want to mention Kathy King has a number of fractures in her spine. And so she's in a lot of pain, if you would pray for Kathy King. There's a lot of other things on this list. Please take it home and pray for these things, but let's pray together now. Lord God, we thank you so much for the opportunity that we have of bringing all of these things to you. pray for Corey and Leslie as they travel, that they would be safe in that trip. We pray for Frida Gosen and Christ for Me Ministries. Lord, that's a powerful, wonderful ministry serving a lot of people. And we ask that you would lead and guide with some of the things that are going on with that ministry at this point. We think of Frank and Kathy King and ask that you would just sustain them, encourage them, give them hope. Give them hope, Lord. And we especially pray for Kathy, that the pain in her back would be able to be taken care of. Lord, here in our own church family, we think of those that we've just mentioned. We think of Cammy, and we think of Bill Campbell and Bill Butler and others that we have been praying for all along. We ask again that you would continue your work in their lives, and we ask that you'd raise them back to full strength. And we ask this in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand one more time before we look into God's Word together and sing this prayer as a preparation. Just a quick reminder that we're asking and inviting all elementary age kids to stick around for the rest of the service here, and we'll be starting back up the elementary children's church pretty soon here. By the way, Cheryl Butler has mentioned to me a couple of times that this is one of her one of their favorite songs, and I mentioned that just because, of course, we want to continue to remember and lift them up in prayer, but also because so many of the songs that we sing are a song of praise to the Lord, but also as we sing, we're encouraging each other and being a testimony to each other. So let's lift this prayer up to the Lord together this morning.
Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Bring the presence of the risen Lord to renew my heart and make me whole. Cause your word to come alive in for what I cannot see. Give me passion for your purity. Holy Spirit, breathe new life in me. Holy Spirit, come abide within. May your joy be seen in all I do. Love enough to cover every sin in each thought and deed and attitude. Kindness to the greatest and the least. Gentleness that sows the path of peace. Turn my strivings into works of grace. Breath of God, show Christ in all I do. Holy Spirit, from creation's birth, giving life to all that God has made. Show your power once again on earth. Cause your church to hunger for your ways. Let the fragrance of our prayers arise. Lead us on the road of sacrifice, that in unity the face of Christ may be clear for all the world to see.
Amen. Now please remain standing as we read God's Word together.
read together with me from Nehemiah chapter 2 and 3. If it please the king, let me have letters addressed to the governors of the province west of the Euphrates River, instructing them to let me travel safely through their territories on my way to Judah. And please give me a letter addressed to Asaph, the manager of the king's forest, instructing him to give me timber. I will need it to make beams for the gates of the temple fortress, for the city walls. And the king granted these requests because the gracious hand of God was on me. So I arrived in Jerusalem 3 days later. I slipped out during the night, taking only a few others with me. I had not told anyone about the plans God had put in my heart for Jerusalem. I said to them, "You know very well what trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire. Let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and end this disgrace." Then I told them about how the gracious hand of God had been on me, and about my conversation with the king. Pastor.
Well, you figured out we're probably in Nehemiah 2 and 3 today. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord God, for the privilege we have of opening your word and studying and learning from it. Touch our hearts today, we ask in your name. Amen. Please be seated. Some of the people say that the book of Nehemiah is about leadership, and specifically about that, and that's why it was written. And I believe there's a lot about leadership in Nehemiah, but I don't think that was the only reason that Nehemiah was written. But maybe you've heard this phrase, failing to plan is planning to fail. Absolutely right. And there it is. And if you look at Nehemiah, he cannot be accused of being someone who failed to plan. He worked hard at planning. Think about Michael Busanis when he flies back up into the mountains, and all the missionaries from UIM that are down there. Here they are getting ready to go, and he goes through all kinds of checks. He has to make sure the fuel is the right amount, that the weight going in the airplane is right, that the weather is okay, all kinds of things that he does. Imagine if you're flying along with Michael, and suddenly about an hour and a half into the trip, he says, "Oh man, I forgot to check the fuel." You can't do that, can you? I mean, that could end in some really bad consequences. So again, that whole idea of planning and being careful in how you plan and looking ahead and saying, okay, what are we going to need? Well, that's what Nehemiah was doing. He was thinking ahead, praying about it, and he had 4 months where he spent time doing exactly that, praying and fasting and thinking, okay, when my chance comes to talk to the king, this is the things I want, this is what I want to do, and this is how it's going to take place. And so he's praying all these things and getting ready. So it's no secret that in verse 1 of chapter 2, it says, "In the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was brought for him, I took the wine and gave it to the king." Now, that's his job. He's the cupbearer. He needs to make sure the king is safe. And then he says this, "I had not been sad in his presence before." So something's different. Nehemiah at this point has gone through 4 months praying, fasting, and working towards seeing something happen in the walls of in Jerusalem itself. And so then the king says in verse 2, "Why does your face look so sad when you are not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart." And so the king notices, hey, you're sad, and this is not just the fact that you don't feel well. This is something serious. Look at Nehemiah's response. "I was very much afraid." The king noticed that he was sad, and that made Nehemiah be afraid. And the reason for that is that in the time and in the culture, the person who had that kind of role and responsibility of cupbearer, you didn't show negative emotions in the king's presence. Those things could be interpreted in all kinds of ways. Maybe the king's thinking, What's going on? Maybe he's poisoning me. That's why he looks this way. You just don't know. And so you didn't show negative emotions for any reason. And so that's why he's afraid. But he goes on in verse 3, he says, may the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when the city where my fathers are buried lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire? And this isn't really great way to put this. This is obviously someone who's been trained, someone who understands. He's been living in this culture all of his life. And even though he's Jewish, he understands what's going on here. And for him to speak of Jerusalem immediately would have been perhaps negative, because this king is the one who made them stop building the wall in Jerusalem. And so instead of that, he says, the city where my ancestors are buried. In other words, where all of my roots are, where my mom and dad, and so he's giving something the king would certainly identify with. They were very much aware of the fact that you take care of your ancestors even after they have passed. You take care of their tomb and all that kind of a thing. So, he says, hey, the city where this has happened is in ruins. And then the king says, what is it that you want? Isn't that awesome? I mean, all of a sudden, all of this 4 months of praying are answered in this one response. The king didn't say, take him out and kill him. He said, what do you want? What is that you're looking for? And then I love what Nehemiah says. In verse 4, the king said to me, what is it that you want? Then I prayed to the God of heaven, and I answered. Okay, so he's saying, hey, I need God, I need some help here. And then he went ahead and jumped in. He says, if it pleases the king, if your servant has found favor in your sight, let him send me to the city in Judah where my fathers are buried so I can rebuild it. So he, again, doesn't mention Jerusalem, but he does mention Judah now. And he says, hey, I want to go back to where my parents and my relatives are buried, and I want to go back and rebuild that city. And he doesn't just say the wall. He wants to rebuild the city as much as possible. And so this is what's happening with Nehemiah at this point. So then the king and the queen, who was with him, asked another question. How long are you going to be gone? How long are you going to be gone? How long will the journey be? When will you be coming back? And then the next phrase, it pleased the king to send me. Amazing answer to prayer. He's been praying for 4 months. Maybe others have been involved in the prayer time. We don't know. But he's saying, hey, this is where I want to go. This is why I want to go. And this is what I want to do. And then I love this part of it. He says, I need letters to the governors of the Transjordan provinces. Let's go ahead and put that first map up there. And you see the red circle, that's where he is. And he wants to go to the provinces beyond the river. If you look at the red squiggly line, that's right where the river is. And when they talk about Trans-Euphrates, everything to the west of that would be called beyond the river, or would be called the Trans-Euphrates provinces. So there's all of that area over there. And he's saying, hey, this is where I need to go. May I have letters to the governors in those areas, so that they will provide me with safe conduct? He says, I don't want to go wandering through Samaria and have them put me in jail because they think I shouldn't be there. And so he asked for letters to those governors for them to basically back off and leave him alone, let him do what he came to do. And he also asked for letters to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest. Now, we don't know where the forest is. Was it nearby? Well, it could have been. There was a lot more treed areas in Israel in that time frame. But we don't know. We do know that he knew the name of the forest keeper. And again, this, think of what he's asking here, and understand Nehemiah has been praying and planning. If he had to do research, he did it, and he found out, oh, the keeper of the king's forest in Judea is Asaph, and that's the guy I need to get the wood from. What does he need wood for? Well, they've got to make the door frames, and they've got to have beams, and all kinds of things that they need wood for. And he's saying, I want king... the king's forest to provide all of this. And the king says, absolutely no problem at all. And that's what it says in a slightly different way. Because of the gracious hand of my God was upon me, the king granted my request. Isn't that awesome? So now, anytime you hear the phrase beyond the river, the promises beyond the river would be those that are on the west side of the Euphrates. If you hear Trans-Euphrates, it's the same thought. It's all of those promises, provinces over in that direction. So let's go to the next one very quickly. This used to be Israel, if you remember, and then it became Judah on the south and Israel in the north. Israel and those people were taken into captivity, and they disappeared into the surrounding countries. Judea, or Judah, was, of course, taken down by Nebuchadnezzar in a number of different times that he came and took captives. That is no longer called Judah. It's now called Judea. And so Judea is that province. There's the province of Samaria, province of Judea, and a couple of those others there, Idumea and Ashdod as well. Some of those had governors over them, and those are the people that he is writing to as he goes. So he takes the letter to the king of the king's forest, and just think of all the meticulous work he's done. He's got letters to these governors. He's got letters to the people that need to give him materials that he needs. And just think about what he's saying. The gracious hand of God was on me. God's gracious hand, God's working in and through me. Now, there's an implication here. I think I'd like to just take a minute to look. Verse 4, the king asked, well, how can I help you? With a prayer to the God of heaven, I answered. I absolutely love that. It's been 4 months, as I mentioned. He's been praying, fasting, thinking, planning. And now when the king asks him, he immediately prays first. So the king says, what can I do for her? And in just an instant, I'm sure he said, Lord God, help. And then he went forward with his discussion with the king. And I love that he does that. It shows us a number of different things. It shows us that prayer is not just for church. It's not just for when I'm having devotions. It's not just, prayer is for all the time. You know, I can be in an attitude of prayer all day long where I see something and I thank the Lord for it, or I ask him, or just am praising him. And Nehemiah has been praying privately, which is that whole idea of persistent personal prayer. But now he's also, in a sense, throwing up what I call an arrow prayer. And an arrow prayer is something that in that instant you know you need God's help. And you shoot off a prayer. Remember Peter, as he's going down in the water, shot off an arrow prayer. Help! And Jesus answered by pulling him out of the water. So that's the kind of prayer. You're ever in a situation where things are difficult, you're struggling. I pray this kind of prayer anytime I'm talking with someone who's asking me for my help in something, or wondering what they can do about it. The whole time I'm just saying, oh, Lord God, I don't have a clue. Please, help me. I can't answer. I can't do this. And just trusting him to come through and do what he does. Jesus said some things about prayer, and I just want to touch on them really quickly. What prayer is not, Matthew 6:5, when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. They love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the street corners. Why do they want to pray? To be seen by men. That's not the kind of prayer that Jesus is interested in. They were missing the essence of prayer, which is we're talking to God. We're coming to him. Now, Jesus made it really clear, I think, here, that prayer does not need to be formal. It can be, but it doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to take place in church. You don't have to be dressed a certain way. You don't have to even use certain kinds of words, fancy flowery words. I remember when we first came back from Mexico, my parents brought us back, and I remember sitting in a prayer meeting one time, and people started praying in English, and English was my second language. And they were praying in an archaic form of English. I had no clue what they were saying. No idea. Now, that's nothing wrong with what they were praying, but the reality is we can pray in the way that we talk to each other, in the way that we talk to our neighbors. It's God, and he understands whatever way we speak. And it doesn't have to be something that's fearful, begging, imploring, or repeating over and over. It's one of those things that we just need to realize prayer comes in all kinds of shapes and sizes and forms, and that's a wonderful thing. Colossians 2, Paul says, devote yourselves to prayer. Be watchful and be thankful. Thessalonians verse 5 says, pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. So again, think the thing that Paul is telling us is devote ourselves and to pray continually. Well, you can't pray continually in the sense of being on your knees beside your bed, but you can certainly all day long be talking to God at different times. You're by yourself, or you're driving, you're in your office, you're doing your work. You can be talking to God about the things that are going on around you. And these four things that came out of these verses. First of all, devote yourselves to prayer. And that's the whole idea of being focused. Be watchful when you're praying. Be alert. Be vigilant. It's like being on guard duty kind of watchfulness. And then continually. Well, you know, again, I wake up, hopefully, there's a prayer on my lips. And all day long, I'm praying to God. I'm praying about the guy that's driving next to me. And I look at him and I think, oh, man, this guy needs the Lord, and so I pray for him. And so there's all kinds of ways that we can pray continually at all times. And then one of the key elements of prayer is the whole idea of giving thanks in all circumstances. Now, many years ago, I was at a place visiting with somebody who was an elder in one of the churches in Detroit, and we went out to lunch, and we ordered, food came. And the food was set down on the table, and all of a sudden, he picked up his fork, and he dove in, and he, you know, halfway through his thing, and I'm just kind of uncomfortably sitting there, because that wasn't my practice. And eventually, he looked up, and he said, something wrong. I said, well, would you mind if I just gave thanks real quick? And he said, oh, yeah, no problem. So I prayed very quickly, and this is what he said afterwards. I guess I've gotten a bit lax in giving public testimony like that. And I didn't say anything, but I thought that crossed my mind was, you don't know what prayer is all about. It isn't about being showy so other people know that you're praying. It's about, hey, God provided this meal. I'm thankful. Lord, thank you. And that's all that it has to be. So our prayer may include things like private prayer times, you know, our time alone with God, and it can include fasting, focusing our thoughts, it can, all kinds of different ways. Group prayer, where we're talking together to God. You know, it doesn't have to be, again, something fancy. It can just be, hey, let's have a word of prayer together. Continual prayer, that ongoing conversation with God, and then, of course, my favorite, and that's arrow prayers, which are fired off instantly, like Peter sinking into the water. Oh, God, help. Anyway, so those are some things that I think come out of some of the applications in the first few verses. So, verse 8, he said, because God's hand was on my side, on me, the king said, go, and he gave me these letters of intent. So between verse 8 and verse 9, he travels, okay? And he goes in verse 9 to the governors of Trans-Euphrates, and he gave them the king's letters, and the king also sent, he didn't ask for this, but the king sent army officers and cavalry with me. So that meant that Nehemiah didn't have to walk like Ezra and Zerubbabel and all the rest. 900 miles is a long way to walk, but it's a whole lot easier on horseback. Still probably took 2 to 3 months to go that kind of a distance. And yet, that's what he was doing. And he brings those letters, and verse 10 says he met with Sanballat and Tobiah. And they heard about what was going on, and they were very disturbed that someone had come to promote the welfare of Israel. Imagine that. Let's go ahead and put that map up there. Again, you've got Sanballat, who was the governor, probably, of the area of Samaria. That's who we know. And he's upset because Judea was part of his area of governance. And now that Nehemiah's come, he's out. He doesn't have that as part of his promise. You've got Sanballat, and you see where the red star is. That's across the Jordan River, and that's probably the area where Tobiah was governor of that area in that place. And so here you've got people that are not happy. They don't want to see Israel succeed. They don't want to see the wall get built. They don't want to see Israel be able to protect itself. And so they're upset. Verse 11, I went to Jerusalem, and after staying 3 days, he goes out at night to check out what's going on with the wall. You can go to the next slide, Keaton. Thanks. So he goes out in the middle of the night. He hasn't told anybody why he's there yet, but must have caused a stir when this guy comes in from the king in Persia with cavalry and people with him. So anyway, he comes. 3 days, he waits, and then that night he goes out and he surveys the wall, sees what needs to be done. Verse 17, he finally gathers everybody together and he says, hey, we are in trouble. Jerusalem is still in ruins. And understand, they've been back a very long time. And so here they are. They've been years and years. They finally built the temple and got that taken care of. But there's just rubble everywhere. And the walls are way down to nothing in various places. And so his thought is, we need to build the wall so that we can then rebuild the city without having to deal with people who are coming in and trying to stop us. And so he sets that forward, and he says, I want to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem so that we won't be a disgrace any longer. I mean, this is a major city, and yet, you know, it was like a little village that didn't have a wall. And that's what's going on at this point. And in the time and in the culture, that was a shameful thing. And he wanted to do something about that. Verse 19, Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite. And then there's another one, Geshem the Arab, heard about it. They started to mock and ridicule. And they said, what are you doing? Because he'd got them working already. Verse 17, they went out and started to get going on the wall and working. And they came out and they ridiculed him. Verse 20, this is his answer to these three different governors from different places around them. I answered them by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding. But as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it. Here you go. We just gave you your walking papers. Go away. You're not wanted here. Go away. We are not scared of you. Go away. God's on our side. That's what he's saying as he says this very, very clearly. And so these three leaders came with a show of force, and they wanted to threaten and make Nehemiah and the people of Jerusalem be scared. And Nehemiah said, you don't scare us. Go away. We've got God. So just an implication here, verse 20 again. The God of heaven will help us succeed. We are his servants. We will start building this wall. You have no share, no legal right, no historic claim in Jerusalem. So I paraphrase this down to a three basic statements. We will build. We are his people. We will build. God will bless. That's what he's promised to do. And you have no claim in Jerusalem. You don't need to be here anymore. It's time for you to go. And that's essentially what he's doing. Now, in the next few chapters, we're going to see how that's a whole lot harder to have happen. But this is the statement that Nehemiah makes, and this is what they believe that God is going to do. Now, I was thinking about this, and I thought, wow, that's a really bold statement. And I loved it. And I thought, I wonder if he understood some of the, well, I'm sure he did, but I was thinking about if he knew the Psalms of Ascent. Psalm 124:1 says, what if the Lord had not been on our side? What a great way to start. Because he may have been sitting there thinking, boy, if God wasn't on our side, we've got these guys we have to deal with. But what if the Lord had not been on our side? And then the next verses say, when people attacked us, they would have swallowed us alive in their anger. The raging water or the fury of it would have overwhelmed us. And then verse 6, praise the Lord who did not let their teeth tear us apart. We escaped like a bird from the hunter's trap. The trap is broken, and we are free. What an incredible thing. This is the God whom we love and serve, and the God who we want to build these walls for. And then the last verse kind of sums it all up really wonderfully. It says, our help is from the Lord. Our help is from the Lord. And by the way, in case you don't know who he is, he's the one who made the heavens and the earth. Okay, so that's the guy who's on our side, and he's the one that we're trusting to take care of this whole situation. And so God will make us successful. We will serve him, and you don't have any share or any part being here. You remember when Elisha was a prophet in the northern kingdom of Israel, long before this, and the king of Syria would come down, and he was trying to catch Israel in some kind of situation where he could have the advantage. And so he laid all kinds of traps for the people of Israel. And every time he tried this, Elisha would send a message to the king of Israel and say, hey, don't go over there because that's where the enemy is. And this happened time after time after time that he warned them about, you know, ambushes that had been set for him. Well, the king of Syria is getting really frustrated. He thinks, this is crazy. Who's telling him what's going on? Who's betraying me, is the way that he put it. And it all came down to the fact that they discovered Elisha was the one who got the news, and he was being directed by God. So he decided, well, let's take care of Elisha. They surround the town of Dothan, where Elisha lived during the night. They've got cavalry, horsemen, they've got a big army all around the city. And eventually, you remember, Elisha's servant gets up, walks out, and he sees the army, and he's scared to death. He runs back, grabs Elisha, comes out and says, what are we going to do? And Elisha's answer was, hey, there's more with us than with them. And the guy looks around and says, you're crazy. And yet, when Elisha prayed, Lord, open his eyes, he then saw the armies of God. And he saw absolutely that the Syrian army didn't have a chance. And then there's a long story after that. If you want to chase that down, that's a great story to read in the book of Kings. But it really struck me, the whole idea of our help is from the Lord. That's where our help comes from. And by the way, our help is from the Lord, the same guy who made everything. He made it all. So he can control and work through it all. Now, in chapter 3, we have a kind of a list of a lot of the work that's done, and it's presented in a way that says, these people did this work, and they completed it, and it was done. Now, it didn't all happen in chapter 3. Chapter 3 is just a discussion of who was doing what, and then we get into the further chapters where we actually go step by step as the wall is being built. But just to kind of give you a sense of it, Eliashib, the high priest, and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate, and they dedicated it and set its doors in place, and then talked about all the building that they did. Now, if you go down through all of the verses, these are the people who were working on the wall. The high priest and fellow priests, the men of Jericho came up with a bunch of them to build on the wall. Men of Tekoa came up to build the wall. Men from Gibeon and Mizpah. People in Jerusalem who were goldsmiths and perfume makers were building the wall. The ruler of half of the district of Jerusalem was helping build the wall. One of the other rulers and all his daughters were helping to build the wall. Residents of Zenoa, Levites, the guard of the east gate, 12 different categories of people were working on the wall. An incredible thing. Stop and think about that. Everyone from the high priest to the rulers to the common people, to the merchants and the craftsmen, everyone was involved working on the wall. One verse is kind of interesting. There was an exception who wasn't working, and Nehemiah calls them out. The next section was replaced by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. So their nobles came along and said, we're not listening to them. If we can't be in charge of the work that we're doing, then we're out of here. So he calls them on it and exposes who they are and what they've done. You got someone, Barak, who is so zealous that he just sets the tone for everybody, and he just wants to build the wall. Let's finish this thing. We can do this. God is on our side. Let's get to work. And away they went. Now, in the next chapters, we'll start to see the people who come against them and the people who try to stop the work. But there's a takeaway here that I want to touch on before we finish. Verse 20, again, from chapter 2. The God of the heavens is the one who will grant us success. We, his servants, will start building, but you have no share, right, or historic claim to Jerusalem. So because God is the one who ordained this, because God is the one who called us to fulfill this huge task, this is a big task, because God has promised to be with us every step of the way in this huge task, we believe it when we say, we will build, God will bless, and you have no part of it. You don't need to be here. We're done. You can leave. So no matter what we're facing in our own lives, one of the things we can always count on is the fact that God is with us. God's omnipresent. What an incredible thing. And so he walks with us through whatever we're going through. Romans 8:31, if God is for us, who can ever be against us? And the answer expected is, nobody. Nobody can be against us. Not when God's for us. God's for us. And Paul writes this, and I'm wondering if people who knew him well didn't stop and say, wait a minute, Paul, 5 times you've had 39 lashes from the Jewish leaders. What do you mean if God is for us, no one can be against us? What about being stoned and left for dead, Paul? How is God with you in that? And Paul would probably answer, these light and momentary troubles. And he would say, if God is for us, no one can be against us. And then, a little bit further in chapter 8, verse 35, love this question because the question is a great one. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? That's the question he asks. And again, people say, well, you got to be kidding. I mean, what about those shipwrecks? And what about this? And what about that? And all the things you've been through, Paul. How can you say this? When you say, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? The answer you're expecting is nobody, nothing. There's nothing that separates us from God's love. Actually, in verse 38, he says, and I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. None of these things can separate us from God. Not death, life, angels, demons, fears, worries, and the powers of hell. None of that can separate us from God's love. And Paul's just laying it out there. And he's been through stuff we just mentioned. And yet Paul's saying, none of that can separate me from God. Verse 39, he goes on to say, no power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus. This section of Romans is one of my all-time favorites for this very reason, because Paul wrote that for us. So that when we read these verses, we can say, yeah, nothing can separate me from the love of God. God is there. God is with me. God is walking side by side. I don't have to fear, even if I'm going through hard, terrible things like Paul did. I'm not alone. I have someone who's walking with me as I go through these hard things. So whatever we're facing, no matter what the difficulty may be, may we go back when we struggle and remind ourselves there's no power in the sky or the earth below. Nothing in all creation can ever separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Nothing. And you can bold that, capitalize it, make it shoot off fireworks, whatever you want to do. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for the example of Nehemiah and the way that he shows us what you're like and how you worked in him and in the people of Israel. And Lord, we just thank you for this book, which shows us so many amazing things on a practical level about you. And we know, Lord God, that you are with each one of us as well in the struggles that we face each day. And so, Lord, I just ask now that as we transition into our time of celebrating the Lord's Supper, that you would help us to sense that truth of that sacrifice which you made for us. And so we thank you, we praise you, and we worship you this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. I want us to read some verses as we prepare our hearts and our minds. Let's go ahead and read these together. For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose him as your ransom. Long before the world began, but now in these last days, he has been revealed for your sakes. And so as we're looking at this and we're realizing, okay, we're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper with the bread and the cup, we remember that there was a ransom paid for each one of us. And it was not a ransom of gold, silver, or anything precious, humanly speaking. It's something divine and amazing and wonderful, and it was the blood of Jesus Christ. So I'm going to watch this video and just kind of keep thinking about where we're headed, and that's to remember what Jesus did for us.
What kind of man welcomes the company of the hurting, helpless, and the hopeless?
What kind of a man can heal the pain with a single soft touch?
What kind of a man multiplies hope and freedom as easily as he does fish and bread?
Who else can turn our dusty old religion into a brand new relationship?
What kind of man would claim to be God in the flesh, but then allow that same flesh to be torn apart?
What kind of a man would embrace betrayal?
Insults. Torture.
Mockery. And death.
And yet, live to tell about it.
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody.
Who could speak with such authoritative words and yet drench them with compassion?
Who could be strong enough to still the storms, yet be so meek and humble?
Who could allow the hands that created the universe to also be nailed into a wooden cross?
Who could choose patience despite deserving immediate and complete obedience?
Who could be blameless and without fault and still endure the judgment others deserve?
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody. Who will love us like him?
Who will be with us when all others have left?
Who comforts us in suffering?
Who is our peace in the midst of anxiety?
Who reassures me when my mind is drowning in doubt?
Who accepts me as I am, with no strings attached?
Who else would die for me while I was sinking in sin?
Who else can turn the grave into Easter morning?
Nobody.
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 Nobody but Jesus.
And that is why we celebrate the Lord's Supper, because nobody but Jesus could do what he did. Let's pray for the bread. Lord, as we move forward and we take these symbols that represent your body, which was broken, just help us to be thinking through the price that you willingly paid to save us. And so we thank you and we praise you. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Daniel's going to lead us in a song, and then we'll take the bread together.
Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What riches of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. He stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Strong.
stronger than darkness through every war. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Daniel, to keep playing and just give us a minute or two to think and reflect. So take a moment to make sure you're ready to take communion. And if you want to just think about what the Lord did for you for just a minute or two. Go ahead and read this verse together, and then we can take the bread. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We take the bread in memory of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to go ahead and pray for the cup, and then we'll sing a song and then take the cup together. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you've made it very clear without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And we thank you that when you came and died, you were the last sacrifice of atonement ever needed, because your perfect life was, and the blood that you shed was for everyone. And we thank you for that gift. In your name we pray. Amen.
There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile and see, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Dear dying lamb, your precious blood shall never lose its power. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. And shall be till I die.
Again, let's just take a moment to reflect and think about what Jesus did for us. Of that last verse, dear dying lamb, your precious blood shall never lose its power. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. Let's read these verses together before we take the cup. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. God presented him as the atoning sacrifice in his blood. And so we take the cup in memory of what the Lord Jesus did for us. I'm going to end by singing a song that asks some questions. And why don't we stand and sing this together?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can my sin erase. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of works, 'tis all of grace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Absolutely love these questions. What can wash away my sin? It's the blood of Jesus. And then, nothing can my sin erase. Well, yeah, one thing. It's the blood of Jesus. And then, this is all my hope and peace, what Jesus did. Let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you that you came, you lived, and you died for us. And we celebrate that this morning, and it's with grateful hearts, full of praise and worship and adoration, that we say, thank you, Lord. Be with us now as we leave. Lord, as we head into this next week, may we realize that we live in the shadow of the cross. And may we do that with our hearts full of praise and adoration. We ask this in your name. Amen. God bless. Have a really great week in the Lord.